Okay, I'm going to go ahead and call the February 18th, 2020 Solon City Council meeting to order. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Here.
Mr. Katuaya?
Here.
Mrs. Manny?
Here.
Mr. Palunas?
Here.
Mr. Russo?
Here.
Mr. Schmitz?
Here.
Mr. Zeller?
Here.
Okay, changes to the agenda. There's one. Item 15 under consent is going to be removed. Announcements are as published. Comments from the audience regarding agenda items only. Any comments from the audience? Okay, I have a set of minutes that we're going to need to get approved.
I make a motion to approve the January 27th, 2020 special council meeting.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion from Mr. Russo, seconded from Mr. Bentley. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katuaya?
Yes.
Mrs. Manny?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zeller?
Yes.
Okay, sir?
Was there a question in the audience?
Okay. Okay. Okay, Planning Commission, we have no items. Moving on to pending, item number one.
Ordinance number 2020-15, and ordinance authorizing payment to the City of Cleveland, Division of Water, for the annual fee charged for the use of water from fire hydrants for the year 2020 and declaring an emergency. And this is a third reading.
Okay, this is the third reading. We discussed this tonight in our finance meeting. So, Jeremy?
I make a motion to approve ordinance number 2020-15, authorizing the payment of the City of Cleveland to the City of Cleveland Division of Water for the annual fee charged for the use of fire hydrants.
Okay. Second.
I have a motion from Mr. Zellwin, seconded from Mr. Russo. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katuaya?
Yes.
Mrs. Manny?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zeller?
Yes.
Okay, item number three.
Okay, item number two.
Oh, I'm sorry, item number two.
Was notification from the planning director regarding amending section 1424.11B3 of the Building and Housing Code to modify plans, examine the fees. This was referred to the Planning Commission and is still pending. There's no new material.
Okay, we discussed this in caucus, and this still will be going in front of the Planning Commission. Item number three.
Item number three is a renewal application for placement of farmland in an agricultural district from Carol Helberg for property located at 6618 Chagrin River Road, permanent parcel numbers 95505004 and 95505005, and this is a public hearing has been scheduled.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead then and open the public hearing. Any comments? Any comments in regards to the public hearing on this matter? No comments. Okay, seeing none, I'm going to go ahead and close the public hearing.
So at this time, Mr. Bentley, I'd like to make the motion to approve the renewal application of farmland and agricultural district located at 661 Chagrin River Road, please.
Second.
Okay, motion for Mr. Bentley, seconded from Mr. Katuaya. Roll call.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katuaya?
Yes.
Mrs. Manny?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zeller?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to correspondence, item number four.
Correspondence was received from the Annual Tax Incentive Review Council regarding a report on community reinvestment area and enterprise zone tax abatement agreements.
Okay, I'm going to need a motion to adjourn the council meeting to convene a meeting.
Tax incentive review first.
It's a separate item.
We need to approve this.
Oh, I gotcha. Okay.
I'll go ahead and make a motion to accept the TIRC's findings and recommendations.
Second.
Okay, motion from Mr. Russo, seconded from Mr. Bentley. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katuaya?
Yes.
Mrs. Manny?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zeller?
Yes.
Okay, so now we can, okay. So now we'll move on to the annual meeting of the Community Improvement Corporation. So I'm going to need a motion to adjourn the council meeting to convene a meeting of the Community Improvement.
Second.
Okay, motion for Mr. Schimmett, seconded, or for Mr. Russo, seconded for Mr. Schimmett. Roll call.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmett?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, I will begin the roll call. To begin the CIC meeting, Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katara? Yeah. Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmett?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
All right, now I'm going to need motion for the following officers of the CIC. Executive Director is myself, the Mayor. President is myself, the Mayor. Vice President, Vice Mayor Meany. Treasurer would be Matt Rubino, Director of Finance, and Secretary would be Carol McConaughey, Clerk of Council.
Make a motion to approve the electors,
the directors.
What was that? So I make a motion to accept the nominations of the electors.
Second.
Officers.
Roll call, Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmett?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Now I'll need a motion and a second to close the nominations.
So moved.
So seconded.
Roll call, Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis? Yes. Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmett?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Now it says Mayor Krause provides a brief explanation of the CIC. It's something that unfortunately we don't use here in Solon. But we should. It's used by a lot of other communities to provide opportunities for community improvement. We've been a little lax in using it. We have the opportunity now in there's a few areas. So one is obviously the Liberty Ford site, which is a area ripe for a redevelopment. The voters have already approved the rezoning of that site. The other area that may be ripe for potential redevelopment is the Uptown Solon site. That's another area that we should be looking at for community improvement. The other thing we're going to be doing is a complete master plan of our community park. The community park is underutilized. It's been underutilized for many, many years. It's basically been used just for recreational purposes. And then we started converting the community park with home days, pop-up in the park, and Fall Fest. We realized that the community park is a formidable asset in our community. It's something that the community wants to see, a lot of different festivals, events. The fact that we actually had home days in a parking lot is absolutely amazing when we had that beautiful park to be able to use for home days. So that's another area we're going to be. Our Community Life Committee is dedicated to providing a master plan looking at the whole park and creating a lot more opportunities. There's obviously going to be down the road a bicentennial park, and that's another opportunity for the CIC to kind of look at and take a look at what is the best use of a bicentennial historic park. So those are just four examples that we've fallen short as a community. And not being able to use community improvement corporations. They're used all over the country. They're used very successfully by communities, and it's time that Solon gets into the 21st century and start using this opportunity. So with that, that's the explanation of what the CIC can possibly do. So now I'll have a motion to adjourn the meeting.
I'll move to adjourn the meeting of the CIC.
Second.
Second.
All right, roll call. Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmett?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, then I'm going to need.
Who did the second?
The second was Jeremy.
I'll take it.
Jeremy.
Okay.
I know a lot of them were speaking up.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, then I'm going to need a motion to reconvene the council meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Russo, seconded by Mr. Schimmett. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunis? Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmett?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to new item number 5.
Ordinance number 2020-20, and ordinance approving change order number 3 to the contract with Fabrizi Trucking and Paving Company Incorporated for the Arbordale Avenue Reconstruction Project.
Okay, this came out of Public Works. The vote was 2-1, 2 in favor of this change order, 1 against. I was the one that voted against it. I have some concerns about this, with this change order. It's all due kind of to utilities, and I'm saying that they weren't idle time because they had to walk off the job. Like I say, I also do have concerns because of the legal liability. The likelihood is they'll turn around and sue us, and I can never be too confident in courts that, you know, we may get the outcome that I think we should. But like I said, I think at that point in Public Works, I just wanted to make a statement of my disapproval of, because I truly do not think the city did anything wrong on this. So I just wanted to let you know my statement and what happened in Public Works. Mark, I don't know if you want to.
This was legislation that was prepared by the Public Works Committee at the request of the Public Works Committee to approve the third change order to the Arbordale Avenue Reconstruction Project. And this would increase the project by cost by $115,351.67 for idle time and lost production that were caused as a result of multiple utility conflicts in the construction area. And while I agree it was no fault of the city's, the project was still being performed by this at the request of the city, and I don't think it was the fault of the contractor as well that these utilities were in places where they weren't known to be. Also, one of the contractors, which happened, or one of the utilities, I should note that two of the utility conflicts were rectified relatively quickly. AT&T took a while, and they were non-responsive to the contractor. And the city also got involved and tried to attempt to expedite the remediation of the conflict with AT&T. And our attempts to contact them were also ignored for a while as well. And that was the reasoning for the construction company to halt production. They, prior to stopping all of the construction work that they were performing, they did pivot and do work in areas where they were able to, where the conflicts didn't present a problem. And it is as a result of all these things that I do feel that the contractor did have idle time, that I ultimately am supportive of change order number 3.
And before you do the motion, Mark, I know, Mr. Russo, this is your ward, and I don't know if you wanted to make any comments about this.
Yeah, I am adamantly opposed to paying this. Contractually, they were responsible for making sure the utilities were placed where they were marked. The city had no responsibility to for this. This is no reflection on the workers and the quality work that Fabrizi does, because they do good work. But the simple fact of the matter is that any time there was an issue that had to be resolved, the first thing that the owner of this firm did was contact his attorney. They did sue us prior to this, and we did have to agree that we would let them do work, and we did all agree, myself included, that we did agree to let them do work in Solon again. But after this incident where they did walk off the job for multiple weeks at a time, I would not want to see them do any more work in Solon. I think it was unconscionable for them to walk off the job the way they did. So I am going to be voting no on this.
Anybody? Okay, Mark, if you want to go ahead and make a motion.
I would like to make a motion to approve change order number 3 to the Arbordale Avenue Reconstruction Project number 2018.17, which will increase the contract value by $115,351.67 under suspension.
That's not, yeah.
Yes, under suspension.
No, this is first.
Under suspension first. You need five votes to get through the suspension.
Can I get a second on that?
Second.
Okay, I have a motion from Mr. Katsouris, seconded from Mr. Zellwin. Roll call under suspension.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katsouris?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
No.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
No.
Mr. Shimmets?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Final passage.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katsouris?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
No.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
No.
Mr. Shimmets?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Motion passed 5-2.
Okay, moving on to the consent agenda, item number 6.
Ordinance number 2020-21, an ordinance authorizing the Director of Finance and the City Engineer to apply for Cuyahoga County Department of Public Works County Road 5050 funding and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Katsouris.
This legislation authorizes the engineering department to apply for funding through the Cuyahoga County Department of Public Works, the road works County Road 5050 funding. This is legislation is being passed under emergency so that we can have the application to the county by the deadline of February 21st, 2020.
Thank you. Item number 7.
Ordinance number 2020-22, an ordinance accepting the bid of Duramark Incorporated for the 2020 annual street striping program.
Mr. Shimmets.
Yes, this ordinance accepts the bid of Duramark for the 2020 annual street striping program in the amount of $209,382.
Thank you. Item number 8.
Ordinance number 2020-23, an ordinance accepting the bid of Trimore Corporation for the 2020 annual emergency and miscellaneous roadway repair program and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Couture.
This legislation awards the 2020 annual emergency and miscellaneous roadway repair program contract 2020.12 to the lowest responsive and responsible bidder, Trimore Corporation, which has experience with this type of work and has actually performed this contract for the city in the years 2011, 2012, 2016, 17, 18, and 2019, with all favorable results. This contract is in the amount of $367,480.
Thank you. Item number 9.
Ordinance number 2020-24, an ordinance accepting the comparison bid of Trax Construction for the 2020 annual sanitary and storm system repair program and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Shimmets.
Yes, this ordinance accepting the bid of the comparison bid of Trax Construction for the 2020 annual sanitary and storm system repair program and declaring an emergency.
Thank you. Item number 10.
Ordinance number 2020-25, an ordinance approving change order number 3 to the contract with Katz Construction Incorporated for the Somp Center Aurora Road Intersection Improvement Project.
Mr. Katsouris.
This legislation approves change order number 3 to the Somp Center Road and Aurora Road Intersection Improvement Project contract 2013.16. This change order actually reduces the contract value by $27.32 as a result of adjustment of contract quantities.
Like those kind of change orders. Item number 11.
Ordinance number 2020-26, an ordinance accepting the bid of NRP Midwest LLC for a two-year contract for the purchase of polymer products for use by the Water Reclamation Department and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Shimmets.
Yes, this ordinance accepts the bid of NRP Midwest LLC for a two-year contract for the purchase of polymer products for use by the Water Reclamation Department and declaring an emergency.
Thank you. Item number 12.
Ordinance number 2020-27, an ordinance authorizing the mayor to enter into a cost-sharing agreement with the Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District in connection with the Miles Road Culvert C-12 replacement project.
Mr. Katsouris.
In 2013, the city entered into an agreement with the regional stormwater management. They entered into a regional stormwater management service agreement with the Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District. And as part of the agreement, the sewer district provides overall stormwater management services to the city of Solon, since there is a small part of their regional stormwater system that is located in the city. Also in the agreement is a reimbursement section for to the city of Solon that's derived from revenues that have been collected from the sewer district for the portion that's located within the city of Solon. The engineering department is proposing to apply $18,250 of the funds that have been collected on Solon's behalf. In this legislation, it authorizes the city to enter into an agreement with the Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District to be reimbursed $18,250 from the city of Solon's Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District Community Cost Share Account to be used for the Miles Road Culvert C-12 replacement project.
Thank you. Item 13.
Ordinance number 2020-28, an ordinance authorizing the Director of Finance to sell vehicles and equipment of no further use to the service, police, and fire departments, and having no further municipal purpose by internet auction.
Mr. Schimmitz.
Yes, this ordinance authorizes the Director of Finance to sell vehicles and equipment of no further use to the service, police, and fire departments, and having no further municipal purpose by internet auction.
Thank you. Item 14.
Ordinance number 2020-29, an ordinance accepting a standard easement for the installation and maintenance of a water main for the purpose of supplying water service for Carrington Court Apartments, LTD. This is phase two.
Mr. Pettore.
As part of the phase two Carrington Court project, water lines are going to be required both for domestic water supply and for fire hydrants. The City of Solon's Fire Department requires access to these lines and associated hydrants in the event that there is a fire, as well as to periodically perform tests on the hydrants. Therefore, the developer must enter into an easement for the water main alignment for the site. The easement is between the developer, which is the Carrington Courts Apartments, LTD, Cleveland Water, and the City of Solon. This legislation accepts that easement.
Thank you. Item 16.
Ordinance number 2020-30, and ordinance approving the final contract adjustment with Cleveland Building Restoration for the Community Center Natatorium Exterior Masonry Repair Project.
Mr. Plunas.
Yes, this was approved at the Safety and Public Properties Committee, and it closes out the contract in the amount of $136,034.
Thank you. Item 17.
Ordinance number 2020-31, an ordinance approving the final contract adjustment with Park Lane Construction for the Service Department Salt Barn Lean-To Addition Project.
Mr. Russo.
Okay, there were no change orders for this contract. This is to close out the contract in the amount of $66,830.
Thank you. Item 18.
Ordinance number 2020-32, an ordinance amending ordinance number 2019-209, authorizing the mayor to enter into a revised wetland mitigation agreement and an additional wetland mitigation agreement with the Stream and Wetland Foundation for the purchase of wetland mitigation credits as part of the Community Center Senior Parking Lot Expansion Project and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Zellwin.
This is an amendment to ordinance number 2019-209 for a parking lot addition to the senior center where we had to purchase an additional wetland mitigation credit.
Thank you. Item 19.
Ordinance number 2020-33, an ordinance authorizing the engineering department to request a scope and fee proposal from GPD Group for the preparation of plans and specifications for the construction of the diverging diamond interchange as part of the traffic engineering services contract and in accordance with the Harper Road corridor evaluation.
Mr. Plunas.
Yes, we had a presentation at the Safety and Public Properties Committee, and this requests a scope and fee proposal from GPD Group for plans for the Harper Road Corridor evaluation.
Thank you. Item number 20.
Ordinance number 2020-34, an ordinance declaring that permanent parcel number 952-17041, comprised of approximately 446 square feet of city-owned property located on Solon Road, east of Cruzy Drive, is not needed for any public purpose, and authorizing the Director of Finance to advertise for bids for the sale of said property and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Russo.
Sure. Based on discussions with the Planning, Law, and Finance Departments, it's the opinion of the Engineering Department that Parcel 3 no longer serves a municipal purpose. So this legislation authorizes the bid and sale of real property.
Thank you. Item 21.
Ordinance number 2020-35, an ordinance accepting the proposal and alternate proposal of Progressive Roofing A.W. Farrell & Son Incorporated for the replacement of the front office roof at the service department and painting services through the Ohio School Council Cooperative Purchasing Program and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Zellwin.
This item is for the accepting the proposal and alternate proposal for a new roof on the service department garage.
Thank you. Item number 22.
Ordinance number 2020-36, an ordinance accepting the proposal of Johnson Controls to upgrade and or replace the HVAC system and TOX alert system at the service department garage through the State of Ohio Cooperative Purchasing Program and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Palunas.
For the safety of the members of the service department and the administrative division of the service department, the Safety and Public Properties Committee recommended the approval of the HVAC system and alert system for carbon monoxide for the service department garage, and it is in the amount of $202,756.17 to upgrade the system.
Thank you. Item number 23.
Ordinance number 2020-37, an ordinance authorizing the Director of Finance to advertise for bids for demolition of city-owned houses located at 34185 Bainbridge Road and 35100 Aurora Road and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Russo.
Sure. The property on Bainbridge Road was purchased with the intent of eventually straightening out the intersection of Bainbridge Road and Somm Center. And the property on Aurora Road was purchased with the intent to build a fire station. And due to the cost of upkeep and repairs, we are looking to demolish these buildings, seeing that there really was no public purpose for those structures.
Okay, thank you. Item number 24.
Ordinance number 2020-38, an ordinance authorizing the purchase of a 2020 Chevrolet Tahoe SSV and a 2020 Chevrolet Colorado from Ganley Chevrolet of Aurora LLC through the State of Ohio Cooperative Purchasing Program for use by the fire department.
Mr. Zellwin.
This ordinance is to authorize the purchase of two vehicles that were budgeted in the 2020 capital plan, one of which is a Chevy Tahoe SSV and the other is a Chevy Colorado under the Ohio Purchasing Agreement.
Thank you. Item 25.
Ordinance number 2020-39, an ordinance authorizing the purchase of six police cruiser vehicles from Ganley Chevrolet of Aurora, LLC, through the State of Ohio Cooperative Purchasing Program and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes, this is for the purchase of six vehicles. Five are special patrol vehicles, and one is for the canine vehicle.
Thank you. Item 26.
Ordinance number 2020-40. An ordinance authorizing the purchase of upfitting equipment for new police cruisers from Hall Public Safety Upfitters and replacement equipment for a destroyed police cruiser from various vendors and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Russo?
Sure. This is for upfitting of the new police cruisers in the prior legislation and also for the in the amount of $82,013.33. And then for the replacement of the damaged vehicle, the upfitting will amount to $18,087.58.
Thank you. Item 27.
Ordinance number 2020-41, an ordinance authorizing the purchase of 13 radar units for use by the police department from MPH Industries Incorporated through the State of Ohio Cooperative Purchasing Program and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Zellwin.
This item is to replace obsolete radar units for the police vehicles through a budgeted capital item in the 2020 capital plan for the police cruisers.
Thank you. Item 28.
Ordinance number 2020-42, and ordinance authorizing the mayor to accept a Northeast Ohio Public Energy Council NOPEC Energized Community Grant and enter into a grant agreement with NOPEC and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Palunas.
Yes, this grant that we're receiving is in the amount of $85,398 from NOPEC, and the title of it is the NOPEC Energized Community Grant, and there are a lot of ideas for grant projects that are listed on here, discussed at the Finance Committee earlier this evening.
Thank you. Item number 29.
Ordinance number 2020-43, an ordinance accepting various bids for athletic equipment and wear for use by various departments for the year 2020 and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Zellman.
This ordinance is accepting bids for athletic apparel and equipment bid out by the Recreation Department for various departments in the city for 2020.
Thank you. Item number 30.
Ordinance number 2020-44, an ordinance accepting the bids of Harold's Turf, LLC, Walker Supply, Nutrient Solutions, and Site One Landscapes for pesticide products for use at Grantwood Recreational Park and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Palunas.
Yes, the bids were solicited for 2020 pesticides, and we accepted and are recommending the lowest bids for each quantity and quality, and the title indicates the winning bidders or the lowest bidders.
Thank you. Item 31.
Ordinance number 2020-45, an ordinance accepting the bids of Site One Landscape, Advanced Turf Solutions, and Nutrient Solutions for fertilizer products for use at Grantwood Recreational Park and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Zellman.
This item is similar to number 30 for pesticides, but in regards to fertilizer products for the use at Grantwood.
Thank you. Item 32.
Ordinance number 2020-46, and ordinance authorizing the Director of Finance to request proposals for cable television government channel administrator and video production services and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Palunas.
Yes, the IT director recommended that we go out for RFP for cable television government channel administrator and video production services, and this is for a one-year contract with an option of two extensions for each 1 year, and the contract that we currently have expires in May.
Thank you. Item 33.
Resolution number 2020-47, authorizing the Director of Finance to sell equipment having no further municipal purpose to the City of Solon by auction and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Zellman.
This item is to approve the use of live auction for items that were removed from the Lynch House prior to the demolition of the property.
Thank you. Item 34.
Ordinance number 2020-48, an ordinance authorizing the execution of then and now certificates by the Director of Finance and the payment of amounts due for various purchase orders and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Palunas.
Yes, this is covers the Exhibit A. They are purchase orders for Chagrin Valley Dispatch, Johnson Controls, Republic Services, Cuyahoga County, and other various entities the city has paid over the past month.
Okay. That's the end of our consent agenda. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Under suspension. To approve the consent agenda under suspension.
There you go. I'll second.
You. Okay, motion thank for you. Mr. Zellman, seconded from Mr. Russo. Roll call under suspension.
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katora?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Shimmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zellman?
Yes.
Final passage?
Mr. Bentley?
Yes.
Mr. Katora?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Shimmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zellman?
Yes.
Okay, comments from the audience? Are there any comments from the audience? And just a reminder, 5 minutes. And please, good evening, and please state your name and address for the record.
Thank you. Jim Ratmore. I live at 32287 Hamilton Court here in Solon. I just wanted to, I was here a few weeks ago speaking on the Lynch House. There were a couple of things that were brought up by this body in response to the support here, and I wanted to address a couple of those things. First was the tenor of the comments that somehow the people supporting the saving of that home were not actively involved for a period of time. When looking back at the history in the last few years, there was not a need to rally the troops until January 21st of this year. From everything I've learned and gathered, speaking to people with firsthand knowledge, this administration came in letting the prior administration know that it was the intention to keep that home. Last May, there was a vote to demolish it, the home, absent an engineer's report, which has yet to be produced or even created, so I'm not sure how that was done. But on the heels of that, there was extensive and detailed conversations, negotiations about a lease for that property. And there was every indication and every impression given that that was going to be the resolution to this issue for that property, that the property would be leased and used. And only on January 21st of this year did that take a turn south. So I know, you know, there were some comments made, why weren't you supporting, why weren't you doing this? People were there, they were watching, they were learning, they were concerned, but until that date last month, things seemed to be on the right path. That's my first point. Secondly, this body, this city, has an issue with regard to owning the property and allowing it to go to waste in the legal sense of what waste is when you talk about real property and homes. If this was a private citizen's home and it was in such condition to deem to be demolished, there would be a record of building code violations issued to the property owner over a period of time with multiple inspections made public record. That is not here in this case. Doesn't exist, hasn't been done. So it seems that the city, or at least part of this body, wants to take advantage of its own neglect of this property, which I think not only is wrong, but contrary to its duty to the citizens of this city and law. The law does not reward waste for your own benefit when it is a public trust. I can assure you of that. There is an alternate path available. It's been discussed and shared, where that property, although for whatever reason, if you wanted to have that that lot available, the home can be sold and moved. That is a viable option that would resolve these issues at no cost to the city. $0. No demolition costs, and certainly no legal fees. I would encourage this body to consider that seriously. That is an outcome that can be controlled by the interested parties and expedited, you know, this in the next 6-7 months from all accounts. That would satisfy many, if not all, of the interests here today. The alternatives, there are two. That the city has to expend tax dollars to demolish the home that takes up approximately 300 square feet of surface area. Yet the plan, as I understand it, and has been repeated to me, the home next to it, known as the Bull Home, will remain. My question is, and I haven't been able to figure this out in a few sleepless nights, is why would one house need to be demolished if the neighboring house remains? What is so special about that 300 square feet?
Your time's almost up, just so you know.
Okay, thank you. The last option, which I consider the nuclear option, and certainly as people would talk about, people who've been in my profession as firemen, the last option would be to litigate this matter with a temporary restraining order preventing the demolition with a preliminary and permanent injunction, where these matters would be litigated in court and both interested parties, all interested parties, would surrender their control over that outcome. And I can assure you from 25 years of experience in the Justice Center, it'd be a whole lot more expensive than $15,000. You could add a zero to that number easily. And that is not something I want to see this city have to do, certainly not something that the interested parties want to do. I'm urging this body to reconsider how to proceed. There is a path here to satisfy the parties involved. Auction the home, have it sold, moved off the property, and relocated so people can enjoy that piece of Solon's history. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
Please state your name and address for the record.
My name is Johanna Hamm. My address is 30501 Wedgwood Drive in Solon. I was born and raised in Solon, class of 95, and Mark, your father, was my principal, and I was very sorry to hear of his passing. He's a wonderful man. After college, my husband and I moved to Cleveland, where we personally renovated our own century home. After having children, we chose to move back to my family home here in Solon and became members of the Historical Society and signed up for the City of Solon notifications on the website. Unfortunately, I did not hear about the Lynch home coming down until it was in the newspapers, so I apologize for my late coming here. For 10 years, I worked in Cleveland City Council and collaborated with many organizations focused on historic preservation, including the Restoration Society, Cleveland Housing Court, and Cuyahoga County Land Bank. We were able to save many structures, but unfortunately, many were lost in the aftermath of the housing crisis of 2007. I personally walked through many condemned properties with building and housing, and even though I've only seen pictures, I truly believe that the Lynch House is a really good candidate for renovation. I have recently spoke with the director of the Restoration Society, and I sent her pictures and brought her up to speed on the situation here in Solon. They have the ability and may be willing to step in as a third party to oversee the renovation of the Lynch Home. This would allow the City of Solon to focus solely on renovating the Bull property and preparing for the bicentennial. The city could also include a clause within the lease agreement to the Historical Society that would prohibit the Lynch home from being used as a storage facility, if that is a concern. The home has so much potential for either an extension of the museum or even a coffee shop, especially because it's located very close to the new proposed bike path. It has a lot of potential. A memorandum of understanding could also be created with the Historical Society to hire a curator to help sort through the historical treasures in time for the bicentennial. It would take 2 weeks to flesh out this idea, and I know it's two more weeks, but it's just two more weeks. And I ask the council to please consider this as a viable option that would address many of the concerns that were previously plaguing this project. Some more time would give the Restoration Society an opportunity to walk through the property and verify that it can renovate the Lynch property in time for the bicentennial. And it would give the law department time to modify the lease. This home has created such momentum in the community behind historic preservation, and what better time to capitalize it than during our bicentennial. The people who came out tonight or previous nights, or who have signed petitions, or have contacted any of you personally, are all potential partners in this cause. They can either be new active members of the Historical Society, they can be volunteers for the Bicentennial, or even candidates for a new Historical Design Review Board, which would prevent these types of situations from happening in the future. It would be a shame to tear down a century home, which is located right in the historic, right in the heart of historic Solon during our Bicentennial year. This home may not have any historical significance per se, like the Bull Home, but it still captures an important time in our collective history and is part of the historic fabric of the street. If it is torn down, it would be the proverbial missing tooth. Having lived in Cleveland during the Renaissance of Tremont and Ohio City, I have witnessed firsthand that these older properties have great economic value because of their character. The craftsmanship that went into their construction cannot be recreated. They embody something greater than ourselves. Thank you for your time and your service to the community.
Thank you. Any further comments from the audience? Any further comments? Okay, thank you. Okay, moving up to the dais comments from council. Which way should I go? Mr. Bentley.
Yes, no comments to you.
No comments, okay. Mr. Couture. Mr. Russo.
No, just a couple comments. Just so everybody does know, because I know this was in the paper last week, wondering how a 3-2 vote in favor of saving the Lynch House failed. Just to let you know, the last time we had a 3-2 vote, it was to tear down the Lynch House. The council did vote to tear it down. It was at that time that Mr. Loby did state that we needed 4 votes for that to pass. And at that time, the administration determined that there was no public purpose and therefore they were not going to put any city money into that property. And that's how we got to where we are today. So, you know, just wanted to make sure everyone was clear on that point, because I've heard this come up over and over again, is how could a 3-2 vote not carry the day? And that's how it, you know, you can't have it one way, one vote, and a second way, on another vote. So that's how that took place. Second thing is that over this past year, I've noticed a significant increase in social media postings on coyotes. And I did have a resident contact me and saying that the city of Beechwood is trapping coyotes. Did talk to Chief Tinelli and Assistant Chief Haynes. They did make some calls to Beechwood, and they found out that Beechwood just decided they were going to start trapping on their own. They did not contact ODNR, and we did. They did not recommend doing that, although you are allowed to trap. It just doesn't solve the problem. We also need data before we could go forward with anything along those lines. So the animal warden has asked that if anyone has any incidences where coyotes have attacked a person or an animal, that they either call the animal warden or go to the city website and log that incident report. And therefore we can collect the data so that if we ever have to do something, we've got data to support taking any action. Those are my comments.
Good, thank you. Mr. Zellman.
Nothing this evening.
Mr. Schimmitz.
Okay, time for our history lesson.
All right.
Sit back, Jeremy. There's a lot of paragraphs. So.
It's not that bad. Okay, first of all, I'd like to thank everybody for coming out this evening and making your comments. I appreciate that. Where we ended up last time was our Bull and Robbins family had finally settled into their cabins, and they became the first legal settlers here in what would become Solon. The third family to settle in the township was that of Oliver Wells. He came in 1821. He also came from Weathersfield and settled in the southwest corner of the township. That would be on the corner of Richmond Road and Broadway, which is now Glen Willow. John Carver and his family arrived in the same year. He built his cabin on a low bluff overlooking a beautiful creek about 1 mile north of Jason Robbins' tract on what is now known as Liberty Road. He, too, is looking for a place to build his home where he can keep his feet dry, because if you remember, everything was pretty much underwater around here. In the next 4 years, three families came into the township, Thomas Marshall, C.M. Leach, and Ichabod Wartress. There were now eight voters in the community. Eliezer Bull had left the community sometime earlier and presumably returned to Weathersfield, but his younger brother, Pitkin Bull, had now come of age and became the eighth voter. It was decided to petition the county commissioners for permission to organize the township by holding an election and renaming the town. This consent was given, and during the late summer and fall, the electors labored to find a name. A Mrs. Deedy, in A History of Solon that was written back in 1909, says the other settlers accorded to Mr. Robbins and Mr. Bull the privileges of naming the town. It is said that Mr. Bull wanted to call it Bulltown. Of course, Mr. Robbins wanted to call it Robbinsburg. But neither one could make that determination. So as they wished some name that would commemorate one of the families, they settled on the second name of Mr. Bull's second son, Lorenzo Solon Bull. Lorenzo Solon Bull was actually number 9 in the family of order of the Burts and was only 12 years old at the time his name was chosen. On the day before Christmas, 1825, the electors met and set up the first organization of the Township of Solon. Jason Robbins, John Carver, and Oliver Wells were elected trustees. Jason Robbins was elected to the office of clerk. Pitkin Bull and Warren Warner were chosen overseers of the poor. Harvey Carver was made constable, and Samuel Bull was elected treasurer. It's evident that Pitkin wasn't the only one to come of age in 1825, for John Carver's son Harvey was a legal voter by election day, and Warren Werner had probably just moved into town. And that's where Solon got its name.
Thank you. Mr.
Palunas.
Nothing tonight. Okay, I have a few things. First of all, even though I'm a day late, Bob, happy birthday yesterday.
Oh, thank you very much.
Hope you have a good one and a wonderful year. So, and to everyone who came this evening, thank you very much. I want to give a shout out. I always hate when employees leave the city of Solon. This person has worked for the city for many years, and her name is Adeline Menadio. Adeline works at the senior center. She was one of the original people to kind of start the senior center. She was in the log cabin. She was right across the street here by the fire station and those strip of stores there for a while. That's where the senior center was. And Adeline has just put her heart and soul into that center, and it would not be what it is today if it weren't for her. Adeline, I wish you the best. We're going to really, really miss you, and have fun in your retirement. I have to give a shout out to this guy here. Last week was the State of the City, and I have to say Eddie did a great job. He actually went into costume and was Mr. Bull, and talked about the history of Solon.
No Bull.
I know, and you were no Bull.
Should have brought me a hat for tonight.
and spoke of the previous mayors, that and the impact that they had on the city. Like I say, I thought it was probably one of the best State of the City speeches I've heard. I think you really laid it out. It was really, really a great speech, and I got to commend the mayor for like bringing it all in, especially it being our bicentennial. And also, I just want to give a shout out to the VFW, which is on Mulberry Street near Station Street. Starting Friday, February 28th, they will be having their fish fry during the Lenten season. So I encourage everyone to please support them. I think they need help from the community, so they have a great fish fry, so if you're so inclined, please give them a look at on Fridays through Lent. So, and I think that is it. So that being said, I'll move on to comments from the administration, starting with the mayor.
So thank you guys for coming. It was a lot of fun. I learned a lot. I read a lot, several books I had to read to understand the history. As you know, we're trying to, with each event that we do for the bicentennial, so this was a time to build
Next month, something I think near and dear to everyone's heart here is going to be a time to serve. So on March 12th, Joe Frankel and our Solon Rotary Club will be putting together 200 service projects for our community. I was just at the Resurrection Church with the food pantry, and even though it's not discussed a lot, we do have a lot of residents here that are in need. They actually are in need of food, in need of various other issues to live and to get by. So it's really an opportunity for all of us to sort of give back and serve. Thank all of you for coming out. I've met with you, spoke to you, many of you, on the phone. It's, you know, I when you're up here, definitely things are not perfect. But I appreciate the opportunity maybe to take a situation where not everyone was happy with or comfortable with, and maybe turning into something positive. I think this is the second meeting now that many of you have come out, and to think about the possibilities for a really cool historical area. I think the gentleman talked about, you know, why the Bull Home. I mean, the Bull Home is, you know, it's an 1860 home from the original settlers of our community. It's in good shape, and the city is committed to putting probably close to $200,000 into the home. It's going to be for public display. There may be some city functions there. Be an opportunity for people to come there. And you know, I've been here 19 years. The public has never come to this area. Unless, you know, Bob and Mary are putting on something, you know, at the Historical Society, the public doesn't come. And the one thing I've realized as mayor is when you start opening things up in the park, doing our events in the park, we had 1,000 people that came to FunFest. We had hundreds of people that came to Pop-Up in the park. And so we have to realize that. We have to bring the public in. The public has to come and see what we have to offer. So the Bull Home is just one example of really providing something, an opportunity for the public. And then the other home, obviously not home, but the Historical Society. And I think several of you have mentioned that you really want to take this opportunity. And Bob and Mary have done amazing work over the years, sometimes by themselves. But it's time that we all, you know, sort of put our heads together and make sure that that Historical Society is the nicest, you know, best it can be. I think there's some work that needs to be done inside. There's probably some work that needs to be done in curating the home. We probably have some things maybe we don't need in there in the Historical Society, but I think it's that opportunity now that you're engaged, you want to help, you want to, you know, move the city forward. And so and that, you know, that has that home, that church has a lot of history. It was the original Disciples Church. It was where President Garfield actually preached in that church. So, I mean, the historical value of both the Historical Society and the Bull Home are extremely significant. And I think we have to look and see, you know, what's the best use of the land there, as far as a bicentennial park and using, you know, various historical markers that we've had, you know, throughout the years, whether it's, you know, something with Nestle, whether it's something with the original train that ran through Seoul, and whether it's some of the artifacts, you know, that we've gathered. I mean, I think it's time that we come together as a community and start to think about, you know, what's the best use of that land. And I welcome your suggestions. I welcome your input. I know Lauren Sue and I met, you know, just last week, and I think we had a good dialogue in moving forward and really begin to take that place there and open it up and let the public in. Let the public see our history. Let the public understand, you know, the 200 years that we've had here. Teach our children, you know, the beauty of history in a community. And have places to gather, have places to really come together as a community. So I just appreciate everyone just coming and expressing your views, expressing your opinions. You can continue to call me and come see me. And I think we can do it if we do it together. I mean, I think we all put our heads together to make sure that we have the best Historical Society, the best area for the future of our community. So thank you.
Mr. Lubbe.
No comments tonight.
Mrs. McConney.
No comments.
Chief Tinelli.
Thank you. No comments this evening.
Chief Shaw.
Nothing this evening. Thank you.
Mr. Rubino.
No comments tonight. Thanks.
Mr. Holly.
No comments.
Mrs. Shaker.
Nothing this evening.
Mr. Dursick.
Nothing tonight. Thank you.
And Mr. Bush.
No comments tonight.
Okay.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Got a motion from Mr. Russo, seconded from Mr. Bentley. Roll call.
Mr. Bentley.
Yes.
Mr. Patora. Mrs. Meany.
Yes.
Mr. Polonis.
Yes.
Mr. Russo.
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz.
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin.
Yes.
Tom, I need you for one second.
Okay. Hey, let's get you straightened out on some of your history numbers. It's pretty hard for
that. Okay. I'll probably.